It's Monday morning, and I'm about to head home. I'm just topping off the battery really quickly while I load up the car. Our next stop is Grand Junction, Colorado, where we're just going to do a quick top-off charge. My philosophy with supercharging on a road trip is that I prefer to do more short stops rather than fewer longer stops. Because what I've found is the car has much greater range than I do. I'm going to have to stop once or twice during that 300 miles just because I'm going to need to use the restroom or stop by a convenience store and pick up a soda. Running out of Glenwood Springs.
Straight to take the Interstate 70 ramp.
See the gondola over there? And we're going to head straight through to Grand Junction, which is about 90 miles away. I'm at the unfortunately named gas station that also had a convenience store. Picked up a energy drink, and we'll get back on the road.
Now turn right to take the Interstate 70 West ramp.
And of course, it would be morally wrong of me not to accelerate full throttle up this exit. Whoa!
This is your last chance to get any kind of federal tax incentive on our cars at all, so jump in, now's the time.
So I spend a lot of time at Grand Junction. I have family here on my wife's side. So she's out here pretty much once a month, sometimes more. But I definitely get out here a few times a year. I really like Grand Junction. Great downtown, lots of really fantastic outdoor opportunities around here. It's just a beautiful place. So I just got back. I stopped by Best Buy, which was just a couple, maybe 500 feet that way, to buy a replacement for my GoPro. So we'll arrive in Price, Utah with about a 23% charge. That's 162 miles from here. That's perfect. So that means we'll be nice and low and we'll be able to get a fast charge, because if you start with like a 20% charge, the charging goes a lot faster. I want to be in the left lane. And there's an issue with auto steer where it is not doing left lane changes lately. I'm not sure why. It'll lane change to the right, but this last update, 20.4, I started having problems with any kind of lane change to the left. Okay, so it should just follow this truck. Oh, just went into navigate on autopilot. So now it's just going to follow this truck up the on-ramp and onto the I-70. There's a huge solar farm to your right and the Grand Mesa to the left. Let's go ahead and put the cruise control at 80. Look at this. That's a pretty decent sized solar farm for out here. I'm not a big believer in solar farms like that. I've always thought it made more sense. What the f, man? We're gonna go ahead and get ahead of that guy. Okay. So, anyway, as I was saying, before I was so rudely interrupted by somebody trying to change lanes into me. I've never been a big believer in solar farms. And I know that's probably an unpopular view in a lot of circles. The key benefit of solar power is its distributed nature. It doesn't make sense to clear out a field and add 100 solar panels. To me, it's better to, on each roof, on each home, add a couple of solar panels. You don't have the power losses that are inherent to transiting electricity across the grid, and it's distributed. One failure doesn't affect anybody but one household. So, to me, it seems like the ideal implementation of solar is to have a couple of panels on each home, on each roof, and each business's roof. You know, maybe it's grid tied. Selling that back to the grid makes sense so that other houses can use it. But it's so much more efficient to just have thousands or millions of solar panels distributed across the state than it is to have one or two massive solar installations that are trying to generate utility power. Now, of course, utilities don't like that because that puts them out of business if everybody generates their own power. But it just seems more efficient, it seems cleaner, it seems like individual homes have more control over the power they generate and consume. So I've never been a big fan of centralizing solar power with a utility model. So most of you folks that are into Tesla have seen all of this stuff. It's all been around for a long time. But my friends and family ask me about the car a lot. And so I wanted to demonstrate some of the Easter eggs for them. I'll put some time code in here so that you can skip past it. It's old hat to you as an existing Tesla fanboy or girl. So when you pull this up, you've got your mileage and your VIN number, then it slides down this drawer that has some capabilities. So I can tap on Mars, and I've been replaced now with, instead of showing the Tesla Model 3, it shows, I think that's the Falcon Heavy right there. And the nav system shows you on Mars, and you are now a little rover that's roaming around on Mars. Not terribly useful, but, you know, still fun. There's a drawing app, which, not sure how useful that is. Maybe fun if you have kids. But I could see it useful for just jotting down a quick note. You have Santa mode. So the way you do this is you use the voice command ho, ho, ho. Ho, ho, ho. So you probably can't see the snow falling there, but there is a little bit of snow. It used to turn you into a sleigh. It doesn't anymore. And the other cars, in theory, should be reindeer, but I don't think they do that anymore. So then you've got emissions testing mode. Very, very important functionality. We're going to go ahead and put this on I'm So Random. But you have lots of different options. You have the Not a Fart, which is, I think, a joke about Not a Flamethrower from the Boring Company. Short Shorts River, which is a reference to people shorting the stock. Falcon Heavy. Ludicrous Fart. Neurostink, which is the joke on Elon's company, Neuralink. And Boring Fart. And then, of course, we can say where it should come from, driver, passenger, or either of the rear seat passengers, and it will place them appropriately. And I think that's it in terms of the things you can do while you're driving, except for more cowbell. So one tap gives you speed-sensitive cruise control. Two taps gives you autopilot. But four taps with the right rhythm gives you more cowbell.
Thank you.
close to Green River. We were planning on going all the way to Price, but I used a little more battery than anticipated. It's now estimating that we'll get to Price with 6% charge. I'm considering whether or not I should stop in Green River. So if you look here, there's a supercharger right there. I'm around a 45% charge, so it might make sense to stop there. I'm not matching the estimated trend, so 6% just doesn't give me enough leeway. I think I'm going to stop in Green River just to be safe. I could also have stayed at the Grand Junction Supercharger for an extra 5 minutes, and that would have given me enough leeway. But it does make sense to just periodically check. Just tap there and say, oh, it says that I'm going to arrive at this place with this, the given level of charge. It's good to know that now, rather than when you're 20 miles away from the supercharger you were planning to go to, and you're at a 1% charge, and suddenly you're sitting there having real range anxiety. But if you keep an eye on it, then you're not going to run into problems. Okay, so navigate on autopilot's off now. We're just in regular autopilot. So we're actually going to have to execute this turn ourselves like an animal. We have a mile and a half to go now that we've gotten off of the I-70, so that's definitely a disadvantage of this supercharger location, because it's not right off of the interstate. You have to go into town a bit. Right within walking distance of that supercharger, there's a museum, there's a hotel, there's a campground. Unfortunately, though, what there isn't is what's right here, like a little truck stop. So you don't have like a convenience store available unless you want to walk a good half a mile, which is a bit much.
Destination is on the right.
There is something cool other than the John Wesley Powell River History Museum, and we'll walk over there since we have some time to kill. That's right, the world's largest watermelon. All right, so charging is starting to slow down to 75 kilowatts and just over 300 miles per hour of charging. We've already added 100 miles of range. I think we're just fine. We can stop now, but let's just go ahead and confirm. Navigate to Pleasant Grove, Utah. It's 127 miles, so I should be more than fine.
Drive west on East Main Street for 2.6 miles.
So it's saying I'll arrive with a 19% charge. I think that's fine. So I'm going to go ahead and get on the road. So we're about 15 miles out of Price, and it occurs to me I should check and see how we're doing on energy. Now, I believe we were projecting to arrive with a 19% charge, and that has improved. Now we're projecting to arrive with a 21% charge. As far as I'm concerned, that's more than enough to get away. So we won't be stopping in Price. We're just going to go straight on to Pleasant Grove. We're in Carbon, Utah. So named because it is a major producer of coal. That has dropped off quite a bit in the last 3 years, but it's still kind of a major industry down there. And you know, as you drive through, you see why. There are huge veins of coal in the rock, entire layers of strata. They're just coal black. All right, so we're going to get back on the road here. I'm going to use up a little electricity here, accelerating. I'm just passing Soldier Summit, kind of a sign that I'm close to home. One of the prettiest parts of the drive, as far as I'm concerned. It's much more green than usual for this time of year. We had a very rainy spring, as did a lot of the western United States. And so we're getting a lot more green, a lot deeper into summer than normal. And I'm absolutely loving it. It's gorgeous. A lot of this area be green, because a pretty nasty fire swept through here maybe a year or two ago. At the time, it was the worst wildfire that was happening in the country, hundreds of acres. But it's starting to come back. You can see a lot of green, a lot of new life, and with the underbrush gone, the risk of that happening again in this area is drastically reduced. We're about to enter Spanish Fork, which means we're kind of coming into the valley that includes Spanish Fork, Provo, and Salt Lake City. It's been a really great trip. The car's done great. We managed to get some rather spirited driving in on a mountain road with very little traffic. Super comfortable, very little fatigue. Now, admittedly, I took a trip that could have been done as a stressful one-day drive, and broke it into two very light days on either end. And autopilot really reduces fatigue. I was worried, you know, as a solo driver on a long drive, you worry about, am I going to get tired? Am I going to run the risk of falling asleep while driving? Well, two things to think about there. One, with autopilot in place, it's not as fatiguing, so you don't get as tired as quickly. But two, if you do fall asleep in any other car, what happens is you go flying off the road and possibly kill a family of people that have nothing to do with it. But in the Tesla, the car would notice that you're not applying torque to the steering wheel, it would warn you, it would beep, and if that didn't wake you up, it would come to a safe stop and turn on the hazard lights. It's pretty good behavior, so while I'm never going to push that, it's good to know that if the worst did happen, the car would reasonably take care of you. We'll be coming up on my exit in a little over 2 miles, and I want to see what it does in terms of getting me to the right lane and actually taking the correct exit. Well, it's about to be a lane change. It's staying over by one, and it's got about a mile to get over another lane, so it should be fine.
In 1 mile, take exit 275 on the right onto Pleasant
Grove
Boulevard.
Okay, so it's telling me that there's an upcoming lane change. See, it's sort of highlighting that lane because it knows that's where it wants to be, but I don't see how it's going to do it unless it slams on the brakes and jumps behind this guy. Yeah, see, this guy, you're either going to have to speed up or slow down, and it's slowing down, so it's going to drop in behind this guy. There it goes. Plenty of room, still got about a quarter mile to the exit.
Turn right onto South Pleasant Grove Boulevard.
I've still changed lanes into this lane, that's nice. 300 feet is when navigate on autopilot ends. Accelerator here. And I'm going to go ahead and turn off the nav system because I just had it navigate me to the center of town. So 1,009 miles, 267 watt-hours per mile, which is really good considering we had a lot of 80 to 85 mile-per-hour roads on our journey, and I wasn't driving particularly efficiently. In fact, if anything, I have a bit of a lead foot and spent a lot of time being fairly aggressive on some mountain roads. So 267 watt-hours per mile, to me, is considerably better than I expected. Consider subscribing so you can catch some of the videos that we have coming up after this series. Thanks for watching.